So good morning, everyone. Thanks for being there for this talk. I know it's very early. So the purpose of this talk is to speak about logical decoding from standby, which is, I think, nice new PG16 feature. So a few words about me. So I'm doing databasing since a long time. I used to do a lot of Oracle, but I fell in love for Postgres. So now I'm working at AWS in the contributor team, Postgres contributor team. You can find me on Twitter as this handle. And this is my blog. So about the agenda. So first of all, we will see what is logical decoding from standby about. After that, we will see the history of this effort, the main challenges that have been faced, and how we address them. Yes. And this new feature in action, hopefully with a live demo and some use case. And also what is missing to achieve a transparent slot failover, which is a new feature we are working on, and hopefully it will be there for 17, but how you could work around that currently, even at 16. So first of all, what is the logical decoding from standby about? So say you have a primary, so currently that's the case. You are doing the primary is doing streaming replication to the standby. And also it could be doing logical decoding as well to a subscriber or a logical decoding plugin. And then you have the application that is using this logical replica and also the primary. And also you can use the standby. So as you can see, the primary is currently doing a lot of stuff. She's handling the application, she's streaming the whole record to the standby, and she is doing the logical decoding as well. So the idea here, to logically decode from the standby, means simply do that. So move this workload from the primary to the standby. So the history of this effort. So the initial proposition has been sent in 2016. Then there is some work, and then there is somehow slowness, and then there is the next major effort in 2018. And the efforts continue during on and off during years. I jumped in this thread in 2021. And I think the reason why it took so long is because it was very challenging to design, and hopefully you will see why. So what are the main challenges that have been faced? So first of all, how to detect and handle conflicts. There is different kinds of conflicts. We will see them and how we handle them. How to handle promotion as well. When you promote the standby, you don't want the logical decoding to stop or to be canceled or whatever. The logical one senders, so the one that are doing the logical decoding who are awake too early on the standby. I will explain all of this. And also other challenges, and probably maybe some that I'm not aware on. So first of all, how to detect row removal conflict. So it could be that replay of all records on the standby, delete data on the standby, that could be needed by the logical decoding. I will just give a simple example. For this to work, I mean, as on this slide, you need hot standby feedback set to off. So here, this is the standby. I create the logical replication slot. Then on the primary, I create a table. I drop the table. So I inserted a tuple in PG class, and with the drop table, I deleted this tuple. And then now you have a vacuum. Remember that there is hot standby feedback set to off. So there is no trace anymore of this table in the catalog. It completely disappeared. And now you want to start the decoding. That cannot work because the decoding needs to access the catalog. So it's not possible to work. So there is a conflict here. So this kind of conflicts affects only catalog or user catalog table, not a standard, not user, not non-catalog table. So in the world records, there is different kind of world records that produce this conflict. So in each of them, we need to have the snapshot conflict horizon, but it's already there, so it was fine. Let's see what it is. It's a simplified version, but so here we have the create table, the drop table. So we can say that the snapshot conflict origin for this particular case is the XID of the drop table. It's simplified, but so we need to know if it affects the catalog table or not, this world record. So we have not a snapshot conflict horizon, but we need to know if it affects a catalog table. So we could rely maybe on the startup process. That's the one that is doing the recovery. So he finds the world records and then he checks in the catalog, yes or no, if it is a catalog. Problem is that the startup process cannot access the catalog. So we need to find another way to handle this case. So basically, what has been done is each world record, so the one that have the snapshot conflict horizon, we need to add a new flag to tell if whether or not this relation or this tuple is linked to a catalog table. So basically, you are there now. Now I am doing my vacuum. Again, it's oversimplified, but I take the snapshot conflict origin, and this is my world record, so there is other stuff in it, obviously. But I have my snapshot conflict origin, and there is a flag which says, yes or no, I am a catalog relation tuple. So it's easy for tables, because the table already contains this information, but not for indexes. It was not there. So we need to know if an index is linked to a catalog table, yes or no. So we tested three approaches. The one needed to do a table open call means once you have the index, we can find the relation associated. We needed to do a table open to check if the relation was a user catalog or a catalog, and then we can say if yes or no the index is a catalog or non-catalog. That was one approach. The second one is to add the dependency between PG table and PG index, so that add a new field like is catalog rel, and so each time you do an update like alter table set user catalog. Again, true or false, so we need to update this. That was another approach that has been tested. Another one that has been tested is to simply between quotes, change the C code and to pass down the relation to each of the functions than when done to this world record. We have the index, but now we will add the table as a parameter of all of this function. So we choose the last one, because the first one we discovered that it could lead to a deadlock sometimes. The second one was too hard to maintain, and so we choose the last one. And I think initially we did a little bit more, and then so Peter he did some cleanup after that. But what do you think? Is all this stuff ever needed? Is if a one off standby feedback is set to on? Who think yes? Who think no? And who thinks it depends? Yeah, usually in IT, it's always it depends. So yeah, it depends if there is a physical replication slot or not on the primary. That does the link between the primary and the standby with the primary slot name parameter. Let me show you why. So you have the primary. So here, imagine you have hot standby feedback set to off, okay? So, does it know the catalog X min of the logical slot on the standby? No, it's not known. Now I put hot standby feedback to on. Yes, now it's known. So here there is no need all the stuff you have done. Now you restart the standby or it crashed, then it's not known. So it starts to be not known. So if there is vacuum now, it could remove stuff that you don't want to. But if you have a physical replication slot, then it's recorded inside it, so it's consistent, persistent, and then now it's always known, even if the standby is done. So to bypass, to bypass all the stuff that you have done, we could simply say, just create a primary physical replication slot and put a standby feedback set to on. That's it. But we did not want to mandate that, so that's why we did all this stuff. First of all, because we can ensure that this is the case on every time on the primary, that he has a physical replication slot. And also, if you do that, if you create this physical replication slot, then if the standby is inactive, you could accumulate while, and so that's not good. So that's why we wanted to make it that way. So I think it was the most challenging one. Now there is another type of conflict. For this to work, we need the wall level set to logical on the primary. So we need to detect when it is not the case. So it was easy, this one, because it's already part of Xlog record. So we just need to check if yes or not, we are receiving a wall record that changed this value. So now how to deal with conflict? So should we remove the slot or invalidate them? So we invalidate them as we are currently doing for a physical slot when there is the wall that is needed are not there, have been deleted. They are being invalidated, so we are doing the same here. Any questions so far? Maybe. No. So how to handle promotion? So we don't want the logical decoding to break during the promotion. You have to use the right timeline, obviously, and not decode what is before the promotion. It was not such of a big deal, but it took some time too, because also there is a lot of code change that has been done in this area during the development cycle. Yeah, so another issue that we found is that logical wall senders were awakened too early on the standby. So logical wall senders are the ones that are doing the logical decoding. Previously, all the wall senders, so physical, so the ones that are pushing the wall to the standby and the logical were awakened at the same time when the wall was flushed, which is perfectly fine on a primary. But on a standby, you cannot do that. You have to wait that the wall is being replayed on the standby before being decoded. So you have to change the way the logical wall senders were awakened, and you have to do the distinction between a logical wall sender and a physical wall sender. So basically, now it works that way. Again, it's simplified. So there is a standby, and there is our process of interest, and there is a cascading standby. So here, let's say this is a wall record coming from the primary. It's going to the wall sender. It's flushed. So now we can start sending this stuff back. So the physical wall sender can send the wall record back to the cascading standby. The startup process can do the recovery of it. And then once it is done, the logical wall sender can start decoding the wall record. Excuse me. And yeah, there is much more also. you had issue about world records alignment due to the fact that we were adding a boolean form and there is extra padding that came into play. We had to create a special function because when you create a logical slot on the standby, it's waiting for a certain type of world record that is coming from the primary. You could emit this world record doing a checkpoint, but it will be too expensive. So we just have a function that emits this world record. Basically, it's the list of the transaction. And there is a lot of tests, the tap test. So when you are testing a feature, so this is a tap test. So this is the second largest in terms of lines. I'm not sure it's a good criteria, but that's the one I found. And so yeah, there is a lot of tests in it. And maybe much more stuff that I am not aware on as I jump in 2021 in this. So finally, what has been committed in core Postgres? It's 8 commits, which is basically what I try to explain here. So it's just not one commit, it's 8 commits to make this new feature work. And I think now it's time for the demo, unless you have question. So let me put that in place. Yeah. Yeah. You know, when you create a table, you can put an option, user table catalog equal true or false. Yeah. Okay. So first of all, we will check how it worked in 15. So here I am just setting a 15 environment on my Mac. 16 environment as well for later on. So here I will start the primary. Okay, and here I will start the standby in 15. So before the new feature, so yes, it's a standby, it's in recovery. So before the new feature, when you wanted to create a logical replication slot, it was not possible. So yeah, just to show you that. So let's stop this stuff. Move to 16 now. So primary standby. Okay, so it's in recovery and now I can create a logical replication slot, there is no error, but you know it's hanging, it's waiting for this whole record to be emitted, as I said. You could do a checkpoint, that will be the same, or if, also that's because the primary is idle, if there is activity, obviously, you don't need to do that. Let's do a simple test. I create a table, I insert some data in it. So, I decode from the standby. So you can see that I was able to decode what has been done on the primary, but it has been decoded from the standby. I am just starting another way to to decode the change on the standby. I insert some data, so it's decoding. Now let's promote the standby. So let me connect again on the standby. So that's the standby. I promote it. So as you can see, the decoding has not been broken. I insert some data now on the new primary. And as you can see, the decoding is just following without any interruption. So I think that's a good stuff here. So let's stop all this stuff and do something else. So I repopulate my environment. I start the primary. I start the standby. I create a table. I create a publication. And I link the both. And on the standby, the publication is replicated, which is normal. I mean, even if E15 it was the case, but it was not usable at all. So yeah, nothing in my table. And now I am starting a subscriber. So I need to create the table. I create the subscription, but from the standby. So let me take the port. It's hanging, okay, because it's waiting for this, because it wants to, it will create a logical replication slot on the standby. I insert some data. On the standby, I got the data. And as I said, it created the replication slot, so it's just to show you that. The subscriber is not in recovery, and I got the data. So I have been able to subscribe from the standby, which was not possible before. Let's do another demo. Clean up this stuff. Here I am creating a cascading standby environment. So this is the standby. Here this is the cascading standby. Okay, so on the primary, I create a table, I create a publication, and I link both. So on the standby, it's in recovery, you have the publication, table is empty. On the cascading standby, same stuff. Now, let's start a subscriber. Okay, so I need to create a table, and I will subscribe. This time, not on the standby, but on the cascading standby. So I need to take the port. So it's waiting for this stuff, because it will create a logical replication slot on the logical standby. Let's insert some data in it. So data is on the standby, on the cascading standby, and then, and also on the subscriber. I promote the standby, I insert some data in it. It's in the cascading standby, and it's also on the subscriber. I promote the cascading standby, I insert some data in it, and the data is on the subscriber as well. So even in a cascading standby context, everything is working fine as well. So I will stop there, I mean, for the cascading stuff. I don't want to enter in a finite loop, cascading. And I am doing another stuff. So I stop all of this. I think now it's time to see the conflicts. So let's start. So here I put a standby feedback to off for the standby. It was on before. I start the standby. It's in recovery. A standby feedback is set to off, and I have my primary slot name, which is kind of useless there. So I create the logical replication slot. So again, it is waiting for this wall record. I create a table. I insert some data in it, and yes, I can decode the change, because we did not vacuum, and anyhow, this table is not a catalog table. Now let's do something else, the one that was in the slide. I create a table, I drop this table, and now yeah, so as you can see, the master slot has no information coming from the standby. Means that if you launch a vacuum, you see here, He removes everything. He does not care about the standby, which means that now if I want to decode, I have an error. So this is the conflict we were talking about previously. So you have a new field now in PG catalog, in PG replication set, a new field which is conflicting, which is true. I cannot get the change, and the only way to move on is just to drop it. I can recreate one. So again, it's waiting for this stuff. I put hot standby feedback to on again. I restart it. So it's on. I still have my master slot. I am redoing the exact same stuff. So I create the table. I drop the table. Now you can see that you have a catalog xmin here, which is coming from the standby, which means that now if I launch a vacuum, you see here, it prevents some row to be deleted. The one that so now you can decode from the logical replication slot because there is no conflict at all here. The row linked to the drop and the create have not been deleted. And this is the one that we are seeing there. Another type of conflict, so the one based on the wall level. So let me change it on the primary. Start the primary. So the logical slot is not conflicting. So I try to decode, but he's saying, no, now you change the wall level on the primary, it has to be at least logical. So you invalidated. The slot has been invalidated. But now what if I put wall level back to logical? And I restart the primary? I still cannot decode from the standby, from this logical slot, because you don't know what could have happened between those changes, which makes sense. So the slot is still conflicting. And again, the only way to move away is to drop this slot. Let's clean up this stuff. Recreate primary, start the primary, start the standby. Here we will see how we can try to synchronize a logical replication slot from the primary to the standby. So I create a logical replication slot on the primary, and I create a logical replication slot on the standby. Okay. I create a table on the primary, I insert some data in it. And I decode on the primary. Now I want to somehow synchronize the slot. So I can get this information here. And here, just advance. So I am taking this information. And here, I am using this function, which allows us to advance the logical replication slot, and I put it here. Okay. So if you do that regularly, so with a cron job or whatever, you can synchronize your slot. But obviously, there is a delay, and it's not perfect. And that's why you are working on it for 17. But what does it mean now? So it changed. So now I insert some data on the primary, so let's say it crashed or whatever. And then from the standby, I want to decode, but I don't want to see what has been already decoded on the primary. And that's why, thanks to the advance, if I decode now from the standby, or you can promote it, which makes more sense, I think, and start launch the exact same command. So you can see I decoded only the last one, so the one that has not been decoded on the primary. And I think that's it for the presentation. Do you have any question?
What's the plan for? What's the plan for 17 to synchronize the slots?
So the plan is to have the slot being synchronized automatically. And
in which way, from primary to standby or also the other way around?
Yeah, so no, primary to standby, yes. So the slot on the standby will be synchronized from the primary.
But if you are replicating from the standby and you want to do other way around, then it's not going to be possible?
Yeah, so we will add a new field when you create a slot on the primary, which is I want it to be able to fail over yes or no. If you put yes, then this slot is automatically recreated on the standby, but then you are not allowed to decode from it.
I see. Would it make sense to also allow the other way around? Because I think many people think that it's safer to use the standby for logical replication, so they don't have load on their primary, and then they may want to continue other way around. It's, I can imagine.
By other way around, you mean create a logical replication set on the standby and synchronize on the primary?
Yeah, or other standbys, in case they change the, then the standby is primary, then they would want to continue from their new standby.
Yeah, exactly. So if you have, after that, if you have a promotion, so you can, there is another parameter that says which standby to synchronize as well, so you can create a new standby, or if the cascade standby is already there, and then it will restart from there automatically. But the other way around, yeah, we did not, it's not implemented. I mean, yeah.
What is the process to decide on the impact of adding a new flag to wall? Because I imagine the decision to add new data to wall might, you know, on the scale of a huge amount of wall, create impact, and I'm curious what sort of testing, if any, was done to decide that that was a good path forward.
Yeah, so what we have done is to try to make this as minimal as possible. So for some wall record, that's a new Boolean, and for other one, there was already a flags field with some bytes that were not used, so we use this instead. And yeah, so we typically try to make it as smaller as possible. But
and did I understand that the new flag is only present on wall for things like PG class or internal tables, or is it present for like any outgoing data?
No, it's only for wall records that already contains the snapshot conflict origin that are being used.
I see.
Not all wall records. So I think that's 8 or 9 of them.
Ah, okay, I see, thank you.
Isn't it for every wall record of this general class, like prune, or in the case of the B-tree, delete, or vacuum?
Yeah.
But it will be used regardless of whether or not you're using the feature. But on the other hand, it's sort of like, with things like alignment padding in the record, sometimes it just doesn't matter, even though technically you're using extra space. It was kind of being wasted anyway. So stuff like that tends to maybe mask it quite well. I'm not really too sure on the details in this case, though.
Yeah, but that's right. It's in the wall record, even if this feature is not used, yeah.
Right. Like a small wall record is 64 bytes, maybe, for like a small insert. So it could just be in the bit you were wasting in the end anyway. So it doesn't necessarily matter, although it can. So it's kind of hard to say. Is that fair? What testing did you do, by the way? Because I meant to look into that.
Yeah, so we did basic testing about if there is an impact on performance and this kind of test. Yeah.
Okay, but in terms of wall volume,
yeah.
I guess you just did a sort of general smoke test of
load. Not that much. I mean, we know what we are adding,
right,
so
right. Okay.
There is no need to test.
All right.
We know the amount of data.
All kinds of table space ID and unnecessary things plenty in the wall, as far as I know. So there's a lot of space wasted, in my opinion, in the wall anyway. Without it,
yeah, I cannot tell.
Hello.
Hello.
You have many standby, more than one. Can you get more than one replication slot?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, you can create as many as you want. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Is there any impact on plugin decoding plugin, or is it is working out of the box?
Yeah.
Like wall to JSON.
Yeah, there is absolutely no change in the way the wall records are decoded. Everything is around like dealing with conflict and this kind of stuff.
As far as I remember, there could be multiple reasons why slots get a conflict, right?
Yeah.
So do you actually store the reason why a slot faced a conflict in the catalog itself?
Not as I can remember. It's just in the log file.
Maybe.
I can be wrong. Honestly, I can be wrong. Okay.
Yeah. If you had a reason behind the slot conflict, if you get a conflict, actually, there is a reason why a conflict happened. Do we store it in the catalog or not? You only get a Boolean flag behind that.
There is the wall level conflict, for example, row removal conflict. So, Michael Lessing, is this distinction made in the PG replication slot somehow?
Thank you.
Thank you.